गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम टू थिंकाई चैनल। टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग एथनोग्राफी, कंपटेटिव एथनोग्राफी, इन विच वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट व्हाट इज एथनोग्राफी। द टर्म एथनोग्राफी रिफर्स टू अ शिफ्ट इन पर्सपेक्टिव फ्रॉम कंपटेटिव स्टडीज ऑफ ह्यूमन कल्चर्स एंड सोसाइटीज दैट आर डन व्हेन द डिसिप्लिन वॉज रूल्ड बाय द इवोल्यूशनरी थ्योरी टू स्ट्रक्चरल फंक्शनलिज्म एंड कल्चरल हिस्टोरिकल पर्सपेक्टिव्स। From a premise of comparing cultures, the norm of cultural relativism was adopted and detailed study of unique cultures became the standard method of anthropology. Thus, cultures were seen either as closed static systems with interdependent parts or as unique products of their history. In either case, a method of constructing a detailed account of one culture by a long-term and close association of the scholar with it as participant observation gave rise to a product called ethnography. Thus, as Agar, A-G-A-R, Agar, 1980, describes it, ethnography is an ambiguous term representing both a process and a product. The product or the writings of ethnography followed varied patterns through the history of the discipline. The earliest ethnographies that we find in the colonial period were often just recording made by administrators who made reports of what they thought were disappearing cultures and ways of life, often because of their own policies. Such ethnographies were made from a vantage point of superior power and were often both ethnocentric and racist. Channa, 1992. The so-called traditional ethnographies were often cast in the mold of holistic descriptions that assume an impersonal language towards the others also regarded as inferior and primitive. This was followed by the rich descriptive ethnographies of the functionalist, where the emphasis shifted to external imposition of rationality on the all manners of institution and practices. But while everything that the so-called primitives did was seen as having a valid point, the rationality was attributed not to the people being studied but to the analyst. Scholars like Ivan Pritchard, for example, gave excellent explanation for the existence of witchcraft among the Azande, but at the same time denied the existence of witchcraft itself. In other words, according to the Ivan Pritchards, the rationality of explanation is located in the scientific epistemology of the West and not in the informants. This is a point disagreed upon by Winch, W-I-N-C-H, Winch, following Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein, W-I-T-T-G-E-N-S-T-E-I-N, who maintained that cross-cultural interpretation should proceed from exploring the internal logic and meanings of defined speech communities. Yulin, 2001. In other words, the scholars creates the ethnography to be intelligible to the language community of his peer groups and not of the community he or she is studying. To Winch, it is not possible to cross the barriers of the fundamental assumptions and interest of the two communities, and that it was simply not possible to come to an understanding of Azande witchcraft from Western scientific premises. While the former are based on universal rules and the latter derive their meanings through intersubjective rules. In other words, unlike science that is based upon knowledge of external objects, anthropology is concerned with other humans and therefore the anthropological relation to the people under study is intersubjective and not a subject-object relationship. This kind of realization completely transformed the trend of ethnographic writings that began to privilege द इंफॉर्मेंट्स वॉइस ओवर दैट ऑफ द एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट. राइटिंग एंड एथनोग्राफी. अकॉर्डिंग टू स्ट्रैथर्न STRATHERN 1999, एंथ्रोपोलॉजिकल राइटिंग्स डिराइव फ्रॉम फील्ड वर्क इज अल्टीमेटली ओनली एन इमेजिनेटिव रिक्रिएशन ऑफ सम ऑफ द मोमेंट्स ऑफ फील्ड वर्क इट्सेल्फ. मोरओवर द आइडियाज एंड नैरेटिव्स व्हिच मेक सेंस ऑफ एवरीडे फील्ड एक्सपीरियंस हैव टू बी रीअरेंज्ड टू मेक सेंस इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ आर्ग्यूमेंट्स एंड एनालिसिस एड्रेस्ड टू another audience. Thus, ethnographic writing creates a second field. Thus, what one reads is not the field as it actually was, but another one neatly constructed with appropriate terminology for consumption by those who speak the same language as the field work. The two fields are tangentially placed, only touching upon each other at certain points but deviating significantly at other points. The only person who inhibits both is the field worker, whose subjective consciousness both mediates and creates. Since the field is not simple or linear, it is a complex situation where things can happen both predictively and unpredictively. One dilemma is always to shift through a myriad of sensory perceptions to decide what to include, what not to include, and also how to include, since the ultimate aim of any ethnography is to add to knowledge to explain. It is difficult in the face of impinging sensation to decide or even to know what it is that will explain and what will build up a reasonably realistic description of what is happening in the field. Since no one really knows what one will come across and things also keep moving while one is observing and in the field, it is upon the intuition of the field worker to recognize certain ethnographic moments, Strathern 1999, moments that will serve to later bring together both the facts of observation and analysis that will provide the key to explanation and understanding of certain phenomena essential to an overall understanding of the culture. One may recreate this moment again and again in the process of writing and use it in a multiple situation of analysis. These can be moments that appear extraordinary or moments that may not take one by surprise when they occur, but in conjunction with other observations became significant later. While writing even one decipher notes and tapes, while writing even as one decipher notes and tapes, one may be struck by one of those moments that may have etched ETCHED themselves in the memory. For example, while entering the field in an upper Himalayan village, I remember coming into a meet of the local office bearers of the village panchayat with the district officials and being struck by the dominance of the local women in this meeting. This particular ethnographic moment then led to me to focus on the gender relations and to further analysis, in which what I had seen began not only to make for sense but to also support a large part of my subsequent analysis. Thus, while writing, we have to shift through hundreds of pages of recorded notes and data in the form of interviews and observations, and these have to be snipped and fitted so as to say into a final shape that would make coherent readings and also explain to the best of one's ability some facts and propositions about the field area. Obviously, these propositions are derived from the body of anthropological theory that is available before one begins to do field work, but often subtle, powerful ethnographic moments may trigger off an additional or alternative mode of thinking that may give rise to a completely different product than what one had visualized in the first place. Many anthropological works that are now seen as pioneering were result of fieldwork experience that set the scholars thinking in completely different directions from what they had initially set out to do. Emil Durkheim went to study the religion of the Australian Aborigines. To study the origin and evolution of religion from the vantage point of what he thought was one of the most primitive forms of religion, but ultimately became a functionalist when he discovered that rituals play a key role, but ultimately become a key role in social solidarity and in creating and maintaining the moral order that supports the social order. Similarly, Margaret Mead was sent to the New Guineas by her teachers, French boys, to study adolescent trauma among the tribes there, but went on to discover that norms informing femininity and masculinity in those cultures did not conform to what she had been told all along as American women, that biology is destiny. She discovered the sex roles and expectations were cultural creations and could vary considerably from culture to culture, thereby putting forth the hypothesis that sex roles are culturally derived and temperaments stereotyped as masculine and feminine are not inherent to men and women but something embedded through cultures. Undoubtedly, there were ethnographic moments, insight and intuitions that led the anthropologist on to such changes in their path of reasoning and analysis, but even if not on such a spectacular stage, even at a much more modest scale, most anthropologists land up writings about the unforeseen and unexpected ones they enter the field area. While writing, we also convert entities, maybe actions, animals, trees, and humans into objects by a process what Strathern, 1999, what Strathern calls reification. When an entity assumes a form by which it can be known, then it becomes a thing. When we write ethnography, we continuously transform our observation by a process of reification into things. A performance can become a ritual, a marriage or theater, an object can become a tool, a gift, or a deity, depending upon the form that it assumes within the scope of our definition. However, it varies whether we use our own conceptualization of form or that of the community whom we are studying in earlier ethnographies that were presumed to be based on the positivist method. The reification was done according to the definition of form given by the cultures of anthropologists so that we could call something by name, such as cross-cousin marriage, an impossibility because in the cultures in which they occurred, they were not and could not possibly have been viewed as marriage between consanguines. Similarly, when I take students to the field, they often come back saying that things as observed or explained by the people do not fit into given categories or into given categories of textbooks. Beyond positivism, it is now more acceptable to refie objects according to their form as accepted in culture in which they occur. Anthropologists have begun to foreground the language of the communities they study rather than reify everything into their own language. Thus, the writing of ethnography is a craft where, although it is not supposed to be a work of art, a degree of artistry is involved, and at least some anthropologists have been credited with producing works comparable with literature. Whether or not we can attain those heights, it is certainly an end product of creativity and judgment, some of which can be intuitive and some based on one's analytical skill and some based on one's subjective consciousness.